is the hardest thing.
Till I'm gathered safely in, lift me like an olive branch and be my homeward dove. Dance me to the end of love. Dance me to the end of love. Oh, let me see your beauty when the witnesses are gone. Let me feel the moving like they do in Babylon. Show me slowly what I only know the limits of. Oh, dance me to the end of love. Dance me to the end.
She'll be accompanied by the former Dean, Professor Andre Borain, as well as the Director of the Center for Human Rights, Professor Francois Yun, as we dedicate this board to the late professor, because it was also his brainchild to have this type of a board in our faculty. So I'd like now to call on the Executive Dean, Professor Schumann, as well as the former Dean, Professor Borain, and Professor Fulyun, the director for the center, for human rights to do the honors, please.
Thank you, Professor Maimela. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to everybody who is joining us from wherever you may be in the world on this live stream. It is my honor to unveil this doctoral board today. This was also one of Christof's dreams and projects, and this was advanced through several dean's offices. And today we have what we see here. There might be a number of you who will recognize your names on this board. It was Christof's intention that everyone who graduates with a doctorate from this Faculty of Law at the University of Pretoria, that person's name should be on this board. You will also notice how the names have changed. And of course, as the years went by, we attracted more students from the rest of the continent and also from the rest of the world. And so what you see here today is a remarkable collection of future scholars from all over the world. In order to maintain this board, you will see that we've already made provision for it to go up and up. And on the top of those empty sheets, we are going to hang that lovely picture of Professor Christof Heyns that you will see in the auditorium today. So eventually, he will be looking down on all of these names, and I think that should give him immense pleasure and pride. So we are dedicating this doctoral board to Professor Christof Heyns, and it is my honor and privilege to do that dedication today. So to Professor Christof Heyns' memory and in his honor, I will now cut the ribbon.
Thank you very much, Dean. Thank you to Professor Falyun as well as Professor Borain for doing this kind gesture to the late Professor Heyns. Colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, as well as to those who are watching the event online, we'll now be moving on the second part of the program, which is in the law auditorium. And it's very much important that we bring it to attention at the early stages that the reason why we are hosting this event as a faculty today is because the last time Professor Heyns spoke in the faculty was in the law auditorium. So in honor of that, we decided that we will hold this memorial in the law auditorium, as well as to show signify his contribution in the law faculty, because that's where he last addressed the faculty in the law auditorium. Please, ladies and gentlemen, let's move in the auditorium so that we can commence with the second part of our program, where colleagues, friends will be able to share the memories which they had with the late Professor Heyns. So thank you, colleagues. Let's please take our seats in the law auditorium. Thank you.
How does it feel? money, but you know you only used to get juiced in it. Nobody's ever taught you how to live out on the street, and now you're gonna have to get used to it. You say you never compromise with a mystery tramp, but now you realize he's not selling.
And everyone joining online, we are now in the Law Auditorium. I have a short tribute to Professor Christof Heyns. I only knew Christof professionally for 18 months, but we shared a passion for and a firm belief in comparative research and scholarship as a tool for finding global solutions, as well as enriching and enhancing our own legal system. We both valued the plethora of solutions offered through comparative methodology and the potential for approximation, harmonization, and unification of laws. We were excited about the new possibilities presented by research platforms created here at the University of Pretoria for inter- and transdisciplinary research and to be impactful on the African continent and beyond. For Christof, it was important to have impact, and he did, also on a global level. Over the past 2 years, he played key roles in the development of General Comment 37 on the rights of peaceful assembly and the drafting of the UN Human Rights Guidance on Less Lethal Weapons, setting the international law standards and UN standards on peaceful and not so peaceful assembly. But he also wanted the faculty to have impact. He initiated various projects to measure our impact. For example, establishing that most South African law academics had obtained their doctorates at the University of Pretoria. And, lately, a project to track citations of UP law academics in court cases all over the world. He was ahead of most with transdisciplinary research, having established research contacts in most faculties across the university, especially in his work on peace and justice. His international network stretched far and wide, as is evident from all the messages of condolence we received. It remains a mystery to me how he managed to keep in touch with everyone, and he did. Personally, not through an assistant. He was just about to embark on a new project, Peace in Our Cities. With no fewer than 22 international institutional partners. Christof lived life in a hurry. There was no time to waste. He could be impatient, especially when starting on a new project and things were not happening quickly enough. He wrote all his emails and WhatsApps in lowercase. I never asked him why. Perhaps because there was no time for capital letters. And yet, Christof always found time to talk to people, despite his busy life. He understood the importance of those more informal, personal bonds that underlie and strengthen professional relationships. This was one of his frustrations during lockdown. Virtual conferences did not provide those valuable and treasured opportunities to connect with people on a social level during coffee sessions, lunches, and dinners. We both became grandparents for the first time last year. That qualified me to receive videos of his grandson, and I reciprocated. Shared pride and joy in our offspring. Christof also told me how this little new life trumped everything else and inspired him. We shared a love of music. During lockdown, we would share videos or lines from songs. Leonard Cohen's dark songs and sharp wit quickly became the perfect soundtrack to lockdown. There were also others, John Grant, Michelle Gurevich. We agreed that songwriters were like scholars. Not only did they have to write their own songs, they also had to perform them, in effect, publish them. As pointed out by other people in the past few weeks, Christof was a peacemaker. After a disagreement in a meeting, the email would come, often late at night, to open up the discussion and give everybody the opportunity to join again. It was as if he knew life was short and there were more important things to do. Christof loved life and he loved interacting with people. He was open to different ideas and alternative views. In the words of Leonard Cohen, "You were born to judge the world, forgive me, but I wasn't." Christof was never born to judge other people. It was this approach that allowed him to welcome so many diverse people into his life. He believed in the inherent goodness of people, and he was determined to find that in everyone. His last favorite book, Humankind by Rutger Bregman, was gifted to many. Those who have not read it or finished reading it, you should. As a faculty, we will honor Christof's legacy by carrying on with the work he started, and we will remain inspired by the impact he had on a national, continental, and global level. Christof was a mensch in the true sense of the word, and today we honor and celebrate his life. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Schumann, for your insightful speech outlining the journey which you traversed with Professor Heyns. Colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, those who are with us in the auditorium, as well as those who are at home, their offices globally because of the global icon which we are celebrating today, we are celebrating. The mood might be somber, but the footprint of Professor Heyns remains visible for us to take forward. It's about there's a challenge for each and every one of us, both in the academy, as well as those who are at home, as well as his children, among other things, to start filling in the gap, as well as the torchbearer in Christof Heyns. He left a great footprint for them to be able to follow. So we are challenged, you and I, as well in the Faculty of Law in particular, to take the legacy of this great giant forward, particularly as well as the students, to take the research projects which Professor Heyns stood for, particularly the aspect of human rights, which was very much dear and key to this great giant which we are celebrating today. Professor Schumann, you touched a very important aspect, as I had also the privilege to attend the memorial service of Professor Heyns this Saturday, and I got to learn that the life of an academic does not have to be boring like it is perceived in society. That the life of an academic, it can be balanced, both professional as well as personal life, to have a good time. Professor Heyns used to sing, played a nice guitar. We saw very wonderful pictures. And to me, that says to us, who are still alive today and have an opportunity to see tomorrow. And with death, we need to remember that tomorrow is not guaranteed. And all of us, we are just mere mortals as we reflect and traverse the journey of life. But the life of Professor Heyns reminds me of a very important quotation which I carry with on a daily basis, that life is not a race, nor a destination, but rather a journey which you ought to enjoy the daily experiences. With those words said, I'd like to now call back the Dean to introduce our next speaker, who is the DVC academic, Professor Norman Duncan, who will be giving his address virtually. Professor Schumann, over to you.
Thank you, Professor Maimela. It is now my privilege to introduce to you Professor Norman Duncan. He is the DVC academic, and he was a very close friend of Christof, as well as a colleague for many years. We are happy that we are able to give Professor Duncan an opportunity this morning to address us as well. He will be doing so virtually. So over to you, Professor Duncan.
Thank you, Professor Schumann. Professor Tawana Kupe, the Vice Chancellor and Principal of the University of Pretoria, of course, Dean of the Faculty of Law, Professor Elsbeth Schumann, colleagues in the Faculty of Law, all other University of Pretoria colleagues, as well as colleagues from other institutions, friends, ladies and gentlemen. Firstly, allow me to express my sincere gratitude for the opportunity afforded me to participate in this event aimed at reflecting on, paying tribute to, and celebrating the life of Professor Christof Heyns. And of course, given the stature of Professor Heyns, I'm profoundly honored to present this eulogy. In part one of the Tibetan book of Living and Dying, Sogyal Rinpoche introduces a frequently quoted statement which reads as follows, and I quote, "Death is a mirror in which the entire meaning of life is reflected." Perhaps this is what the function of a eulogy is, to use dying, this important life event, which all of us will experience, as one of the opportunities afforded those who have been close to us to affirm and celebrate life, particularly a life well lived, a life lived to the fullest. Reading Sogyal Rinpoche's statement certainly brings Christof's life, his life contributions, and the value of his contributions to society into vivid relief. Colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, let me indicate here that I will only speak of Christof's contributions to the University of Pretoria and broader society that I am familiar with. I'm sure that his very significant contributions that I will not speak of will be broached by others participating in this event. First, how did I come to know Christof Heyns? Well, many, many years ago, while I was still teaching at the University of Venda, I collaborated on various initiatives with someone who became a very close colleague and friend, namely Dr. Murray Hofmeyer. When we first met, I think we were working on a volume on race and racism at the time. Murray Hofmeyer spoke constantly of his close friend, Christof Heyns, and about his work for the Center for Human Rights and his inspiring work for the Southern African Student Volunteer Organization, SASVO, an organization that he had established. Murray impressed upon me that Christof was an academic that I simply had to meet. Well, as impressed as I was with Christof's academic work, I'd read some of it, and the various civic initiatives in which he was involved, a few years passed before I eventually had the opportunity to meet Christof. First, on a telephone call about the critical matter that was being debated at the University of Pretoria at that time, and at the time I was still at Wits, and then later, we met in person when I joined the University of Pretoria. When I first met Christof, I realized that Murray had not exaggerated. I realized that I was engaging with, first and foremost, a critical scholar of note. And of course, his extensive scholarly output, or rather his scholarly legacy, attests to this. In our first meeting, I also realized that above all, I was in conversation with a person with boundless energy for initiating new ventures aimed at improving the learning opportunities provided to our students, ventures aimed at advancing the interests of academia more broadly, as well as ventures involving international human rights and many other causes close to his heart. During the course of our friendship, Christof drew me into various initiatives in which he was involved, as he did with many others I know. For today's occasion, I single out three of these initiatives because of their significance to me and my work on the one hand, and what they illustrate about Christof, the scholar, academic activist, and benefactor on the other. The first of these initiatives relates to a task assigned to me by the university executive in 2016. At the time, various student formations made it known to the university that they were unhappy about the absence of a policy on homophobia at the University of Pretoria. I immediately approached Christof, given his background, for his assistance. In our subsequent discussions, we agreed that developing a policy dealing with homophobia, only with homophobia, and then to add it to the university's policy on racial discrimination would result in the university ending up with a patchwork of anti-discrimination policies. It was then agreed that we should rather develop an omnibus anti-discrimination policy that would address all forms of discrimination at UP. Professor Heyns immediately set to work on this project with the assistance of Professor Anton Kok, and various others, including Pierre Brouard, as well as Mary. The current UP anti-discrimination policy is a result of Christof's initial conceptualization and input. A second initiative in which I was involved with Christof is a reading group of sorts, and I'm sure that many of you had been involved in reading initiatives with Christof as well. I remember that Christof, from year to year, and Prof, the Dean had indicated this earlier, from year to year, he handed out books to all his friends and colleagues. The one year he had handed out a book written by Brynjolfsson and McCarthy. The book is The Second Machine Age. He handed out various books by Yuval Harari, and most recently, as Professor Schumann had indicated, Humankind, written by Rutger Bregman. Importantly, however, Christof invited a few of his friends to have a discussion around the meaning of these books and what they signify to academia. It was our discussions on the implications of the arguments proposed by Brynjolfsson and McCarthy, as well as Harari, that influenced many of my endeavors in relation to teaching and in relation to my teaching and learning portfolio at the University of Pretoria. Our discussion certainly inspired me to encourage a greater future directedness in our teaching and learning programs. The third initiative was an internship project aimed at offering UP students an opportunity to be exposed to the work of the AU, the UN, and metropolitan governance structures. Due to the COVID-19 pandemic, this initiative has not yet come to full fruition. I am, however, committed to lending whatever support I can to the realization of this venture in the year ahead. Of course, ladies and gentlemen, I'm keenly aware of Christof's many other important contributions to academia and society more broadly, including his contributions to the University of Pretoria in particular, first as the director of the Center for Human Rights, then as the Dean of the Faculty of Law, and most recently as the director of the Institute for International and Comparative Law in Africa, or ICLA. I'm also aware of and here wish to acknowledge his signally influential role in the African Human Rights Moot Court competition and his role in the establishment of the Nelson Mandela World Human Rights Moot Court competition and the South African National Schools Moot Court competition. Christof's exceptional and seminal contributions to human rights internationally have been written about extensively, and I will consequently not detail these at this point. Suffice it to state that, as Amnesty International recently put it, and I quote, Christof Heyns was a baobab in the human rights world, a giant in his field who fought hard for a just world, close quote. On a more personal note, with the passage of time, I also realized that Christof did not only care deeply for the issues that I've just mentioned, but that he also cared deeply about his family and friends. And anyone who spent any significant period of time with Christof would also have realized that he was remarkably caring and humble. A mensch, as Advocate Thuli Madonsela recently described him, and most recently the Dean. One of his former students, Patrick Eber, the current UNAIDS country director for the Central African Republic, recently said of Christof, and I quote, he was a thought leader who embodied the values of excellence with Ubuntu, close quote. As most of us know, especially those of us who work in the field of psychology, that authentically caring for others in the way that Christof did is very frequently reciprocated by a similar engagement on the part of those at whom his caring or this caring is directed. So those who knew Christof invariably cared deeply for him. Colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, this is meant to be a celebratory occasion. And while I fully agree with this laudable intention on the part of the Faculty of Law, it will be remiss of me if I do not also acknowledge that celebrating the life of Christof Heyns comes on the back of a sense of intense loss on the part of those who care deeply for him, including his family and close friends. And it is in acknowledgement of this sense of loss, and perhaps in an effort to assuage it, that I wish to read a few lines from Maya Angelou's poem, When Grey Trees Fall. Earlier, I had quoted Amnesty International's reference to Christof as a baobab tree. It was when I read this quote that I was reminded of Angelou's poem, when great trees fall. Colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, I will read from the first, second, and fourth stanzas of the poem by way of concluding my tribute. When great trees fall, by Maya Angelou. When great trees fall, rocks on distant hills shudder. When great souls die, the air around us becomes light, rare, sterile. We breathe briefly. Our eyes briefly see with a hurtful clarity. Our memory, suddenly sharpened, examines, gnaws on kind words unsaid, promised walks never taken. And when great souls die, after a period, peace blooms, slowly and always irregularly. Spaces fall with a kind of soothing electric vibration. Our senses, restored, never to be the same, whisper to us, they existed. We can be and be better, for they existed. Colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, with your indulgence, I want to adapt the last line in the poem as follows for this occasion. And I quote, people like Christof Heyns existed. They existed. We can be and be better, for people like Christof Heyns existed. Colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, DVC academic Professor Norman Duncan, for the eulogy as well as the dedication and the warm message which you gave to us as a faculty, to Christof's family and the broader community. But also in your address, you are highlighting the important role which academics played, and we see it with the work of Professor Heyns, that we do not only scream and shout in the classrooms and where students only complain about our work as to how difficult the test is, but the real work of an academic is to contribute significantly to society and make society a better world. And we see it outlined in the work of Professor Heyns, and hence the outpouring messages which we received from a number of stakeholders in society, not only in the academic sphere. And colleagues, we also remember, based on the contribution made by Professor Heyns, and as one would quote that the poem by Maya Angelou, which she wrote after Nelson Mandela's passing, that his day is done. But as a faculty, we cannot say that due to the immense contribution Professor Heyns has made, as well as the vast contribution, bearing in mind the solid foundation which he has laid in his scholarly work and contribution as a peacemaker. For us as a faculty and as colleagues, we can say firmly that is a beginning of a new era, and take the projects which Professor Heyns has laid for us forward as we continue with our journey of life, because our journey of life is not guaranteed. Thank you, DVC, once more for your message. We truly appreciate the message. Colleagues, now we move to our program. I'm used to agendas, meetings. You are being programmed when you attend lots of meetings. Apologies for that. But colleagues, friends, family, now please allow us to go to our program, where now we'll be doing the eulogy circle. The first circle, I would like to now call the participants who will be sitting on my left for us to be able to engage as well as to reflect with us. As I call them, I call in the director for the Center for Human Rights, Professor Frans Viljoen, to the circle. I call upon Professor Dire Cladi from ITLA to join. I call on Professor Charles Fombat, who will be joining virtually. I also call upon Professor Fombat is a senior professor in the Center for Human Rights. I also call upon Dr. Danny Bradlow, who will be joining virtually. He's the SACHI chair in our faculty. He will be joining us virtually. Colleagues have 25 minutes to give a reflection on the journey they've traversed with the late Professor Heyns. I will hand over to the moderator, and I will give a sign that around 12, they should sum up their reflections. Professor Frans Viljoen, over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, Professor Maimela. Yes, indeed, as others have said, it is a moment of sadness and awareness of loss that brings us here, but certainly also a feeling of great solidarity for the many of us who miss Christof in immeasurable ways. We think of that, but we also, I think, for myself, find great solace in the knowledge that what we do, particularly at the center, and what many of us do, is a continuation of Christof's manifold legacy. I think what we know is that Christof is an international icon. He has influenced people, institutions across the world. But he did so essentially from here. He was here at the University of Pretoria, the Faculty of Law, at the Center for Human Rights. And I think he was, in a sense, a homebody. It was the security, the solidity of this rootedness that, in part, helped Christof, gave him strength. He drew from that. At the University of Pretoria, he was instrumental, influential, pivotal in the establishment of the Center for Human Rights, the running of the center, the way in which the center grew over the years, but also after his deanship in the establishment of the Institute for International Comparative Law in Africa, ICLA, as we heard, and within the center of the International Development Law Unit, IDLU. And in a sense, for all of us, these are, in a sense, close cousins, brothers and sisters, part of a family. So I have heard many metaphors being used for Christof: baobab, lion, giant, and all of those are very, very apt. But I have one of my own, and that is magnet. I think if one encountered Christof, it was as if his magnetism, not deliberate, but almost automatically just pulled you in as a person, made you part, made you feel that you belong there, that you were part of his mission plan and his presence. And I think the members of our panel, each of them would also, in a sense, have been drawn to the University of Pretoria, to the positions that they hold today. And I ask, perhaps starting with Professor Bradlow, with Danny, to just reflect a little bit on how it is that Christof also influenced you in the sense of drawing you to the position, to IDLU, where you are today. Danny, if we may hear from you, please.
Thank you, Frans. Can you hear me?
Yes, please proceed.
Thanks. Well, the short answer is I keep saying I'm in South Africa and I'm at the University of Pretoria because of Christof. I met him at a conference in Addis of the African International Law Society many years ago. And at the time I was looking to develop cooperations between American University, where I was teaching at the time, and a university in South Africa. And I hadn't had any success with any of the universities that I had spoken to. And the minute that I raised this with Christof, it was as if all sorts of possibilities, both for me and for my colleagues at American University, opened up. And it was the beginning of a very fruitful relationship. And eventually, Christof came to me one day and said that the NRF was beginning a program to create some Saatchi chairs, and he thought that I should apply for one of those chairs, which I did. And that was responsible for getting me here. And it was the reason I decided to do it was I thought it could be nothing better than coming to university where people like Christof were, where there would be this space to collaborate and have intellectual engagements with people like him. And that's proved to be the case since that time. So I have great gratitude and for Christof for bringing me here. And today want to celebrate his life rather than just mourn the loss, which I think will be something we'll continue doing for a long time.
Thank you very much, Danny. Thank you very much, Danny. Yes, maybe Professor Fombat, Charles, we turn to you to also reflect on that same gravitational pull that Christof may exerted also on your life professionally. Charles.
Thank you very much, Franz. I feel greatly privileged and honored to have known Christof, Heyns, from when I joined the University of Pretoria in January 2010. At that stage, she was the dean of the faculty and was instrumental in my appointment. Before then, I had met Christof on two occasions when he was the director of the Center for Human Rights. The strong impression he made on me on those two occasions were the main reason why, when I received the invitation to join the University of Pretoria, I did not hesitate. Things only got better for me when I joined him at the Institute for International and Comparative Law in Africa. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Charles, for sharing that with us. And then the same question, in a sense, goes to Professor Dira Tladi, who has also not only been a member, or is not only a member of the Department of Public Law, but also closely associated with ICLA. Over to you, Dira, please.
Thank you, Franz. When you mention magnet, that is one I hadn't heard, but I think it's apt, and I'll just share something really quickly. I've never liked legal philosophy as a course, but Christof taught me that subject, and when he taught me the subject, I actually thought I liked it, and I think that must have something to do with with Christof Heyns and the magnetic pull that you speak of. So I came to the University of Pretoria three times. The first time I came as a student. I'm sure Christof had nothing to do with that. I don't think he knew me. The second time was when I was appointed as a junior lecturer here. I don't know what Christof had to do with that. I know that you were the leader on that particular project. But the third time I came back to the University of Pretoria in 2014, many people played a leading role. The dean at the time, Andre, the head of department at the time, Peter Carstens, but actually nobody played a bigger role behind the scene. I mean, it all started when Christof was appointed as a special rapporteur at the Human Rights Council. Every year he made an appearance at the General Assembly. At the time I was based in New York, and we would meet at an Irish bar, McFadden's, on 42nd Street and 2nd Avenue, and we would share beer. And on one of these meetings, Christof said to me, if you ever decide to come back to academia, make sure I'm the first person you tell. I must confess, when I decided to come back to academia, I didn't tell Christof, because at that point my heart was sort of set on UCT. But as things turn out, Christof heard about it, and he reached out to me, and we had a couple of meetings. And then shortly thereafter, Andre called me, and that started the process. But actually, even after the formal process began of Christof, I guess to make sure I don't change my mind, he often invited me to the university, and he showed me the wonderful building, which was one of the main reasons. I mean, I thought it was a beautiful building, and of course, he shared with me the wonderful work that they were doing. I'm in the ICLA, and that's certainly one of the main reasons why I'm here.
Thank you, Peter, for that.
Move the microphones. Thank you, Dira, for that. Yes, so let us move then to his professional influence, the work that Christof did, and how he impacted with his work and working with us each in different ways. I think we've heard much about the African, the world, the school's moot court competitions. We've heard about SASVO, the Student Volunteers Project. I just like to add one to that, and that is the Integrated Bar Project. Very early on, Christof identified a project that brought senior law students, senior black law students, and created opportunities for them to do internships at South African law firms. And that really set up quite a number of these students early on, and we're talking about the 90s here, into a professional opportunity that I'm sure otherwise they would not have had. And the other one is the Pretoria University Law Press. I'm sure that Professor Charles Fombat, who I will invite to also speak about the work that he had done with Christof, will talk about that. But may I just say that this is another example of Christof's work that continues, because he worked on, and I have to show this, I'm sure Christof was also someone who liked concreteness. This is a book. You can look at it afterwards. It's a magnus opus. It's a doorstopper. It is a collection of all the work that special rapporteurs did on extrajudicial killing, with commentary by Philip Alston and Professor Heyns. This was available previously online, but it has now been printed finally. And regrettably, Christof would never hold this in his hands, but we just know how much joy this would have given him. And it's such a testament, again, testimony to the great work that he was doing on an ongoing basis. But Charles, if I may revert to you to share with us some of your professional related experiences with Christof, please.
Thank you again, Franz. Christof and I worked together for 12 years on academic matters. He was not only the academic giant we all knew him as, but was, in many respects, a wonderful mentor to me and the unsung hero behind most of my accomplishments since I joined ICLA. For example, Christof took a proposal of mine, which had been rejected by other organizations, to the Stellenbosch Institute for Advanced Study. The result of his support was the establishment of the Stellenbosch Annual Seminar on Constitutionalism in Africa, a project from which no less than 5 books have been published by the Oxford University Press. As a further example, Christof and the former co-director of ICLA negotiated for me to co-edit commentaries on African constitutions as part of the collection Oxford Constitutions of the Countries of the World Online. What stands out in my memory was that Christof and the former co-director insisted that Oxford University Press must allow the African reports to be published and made available free of charge on the ICLA website. There are many more such achievements, like the part which you mentioned earlier, which attests to Christof's creativity and his visionary cast of mind, but this tool suffice. Let me say our eyes are wet with tears. Though the angel came like a thief in the night and took Christof by the hand and said, his place was ready in heaven, his love and friendship will endure in our hearts. The sharpness of our grief is tampered by our knowledge of what he has left behind for us. A legacy so large and strong that it will live on for generations to come. In the sands of time, Christof has left his giant footprints that academics, policymakers, and human rights activists, young and old, and yet unborn, will aspire to follow. Thank you, Franz.
Thank you. Thank you, Charles, for those very, very poignant and powerful words. I just think that I would, you know, want to share, just as I hand over to back to Danny, also just my thought about Christof's ability to balance, because as much as he was this great man, this giant, that had the world vision in his mind and could engage at the highest level with statesmen and kept that big picture, he was also able to really attend to the most meticulous detail. I think Lizette at Pretoria University Law Press and others would remember Christof also for the way in which he could dissect sentences and notice whatever needs to be done in terms of footnotes. And I think it is singular and extraordinary for someone in one human being to hold together those two vastly kind of different polar possibilities and talents. And Christof was just magnificent in being able to do so. But Danny, let us move to you to also share with us some of your professional experiences with Christof, related to Christof's life.
So Franz, I'm often asked around the world, I'm responsible for an LLM in trade and investment law, and people say to me, how does a trade and investment law end up in a center for human rights? And that's really a testament to Christof's breadth of vision and his creativity. He had some, through his incredible network of contacts, he learned many things. And one of which was that he came to me one day when we were having lunch in Washington and said, I understand that you had run some workshops to train academics in South Africa to teach international trade and investment law. I think we should work together to develop an LLM in international trade and investment law. South Africa needs something like that. And I thought, fine, nice idea. I'm happy to talk to you about that, but I didn't really expect much to come from that. But that was because I didn't really know about Christof's drives and determination. And before I knew it, I was on a plane back to South Africa to a workshop to sit with him and to work out how to set up such an LLM. And we quickly realized that it was very important that we set up an LLM on trade and investment law in the Center for Human Rights, because it was important both for South Africa and globally that international trade and investment lawyers should learn about human rights, and that human rights lawyers should know something about trade and investment law. And so having the two LLMs in the Center for Human Rights created opportunities that wouldn't exist otherwise. And when we set it up, it was one of the first times anywhere that I knew of where there was an effort to bring these two fields, which seemed so different, together and to create something around, we hope eventually, what will become a cadre of lawyers who understand business and human rights issues in a holistic way. And that's really a testament to Christof's vision and understanding of that.
Thank you, Danny, for reminding us and sharing also that with us. I think one has to link that also to his development, his initiative, his vision in respect of the Masters in Human Rights and Democratization in Africa. I think famously he got wind of this program that was being run in Europe that brought together a number of universities, and he took the initiative to conceptualize a similar model for Africa. He got the funding, and I think one of the greatest legacies that Christof leaves would be the great number of graduates of that program that had been formed, been forged partly by Christof, and who are continuously doing great work that continue his vision, his mission, his hands will be active in many parts of the world through all of these graduates in many, many years to come. So yes, I think he's been visionary and able to make his visions actually real. Dira, over to you.
Thank you, Franz. When you were reeling off some of the projects that aren't often mentioned, I thought about one project that I think I haven't seen in any of the tributes to Christof. And it was actually my first involvement at the Center for Human Rights. It was in 1994, the Democracy Education Program. I don't think I've seen it in any of the literature. It was a program basically to teach people in the poorest of places about voting and democracy and so on. So that's certainly a project that I think very fondly of. Christof and I were actually are supposed to, and I'm sure we will continue along in that vein. We're supposed to co-host on December the 13th, 14th, and 15th the annual junior academics on international law forum. So that's a project that we were supposed to do. It's a forum that has been held in different parts of the year for the last 10 years. It would have been the 10th year, and we were going to host it. We're going to co-host it in Pretoria this year. So that's one project that I was meant to do with Christof this year. But what I really want to talk about is the impact that Christof has had on my life, and it's an indirect. I think the biggest impact that he's had in my life is actually an indirect impact, but it's also the most significant. It's not something I thought about until his passing, but I don't think that I would be an international lawyer if it wasn't for Christof, because if you remember, Franz, in 1995, I was a second-year law student. and I participated in the All Africa Moot Court competition. I didn't realize that it was Christof's brainchild. And I can tell you, when I argued that case for Professor Africa against some university, by the way, Joel, Professor Africa reminds me of you. But when I argued that case for Professor Africa in Oujda, Morocco, I knew I wasn't interested in company law, contract law, family law. I knew I wanted to be an international lawyer. So in a way, even if I'd never met him, even if I had never had the many conversations I've had with him, this is so.
Thank you, Dira. I think that is just so telling, because I think what the narrative you recount is certainly applicable to thousands and thousands of young lawyers, and we do see so many of them that actually experience the moot, Christof's moot, and the very idea that he put behind it in the same way. So, Chief Moderator, I know we are running within time limits. I'm just going to go around and ask each of our panelists also to just give, at a more personal level, maybe beyond the professional, some pertinent reflections that maybe they have most fondly remembrance of, as far as Christof is concerned. But permit me, before I do so, to just also read a few lines from Johan van der Westhuizen, Justice van der Westhuizen, as you know, was the founding director of the center. He's unable to be here today, but he said, Christof is one of the very few people with whom I could talk about matters that really mattered. And he then says that they had their disagreements, but disagreement, in a sense, is the test of friendship. But he also added that he suspects that one of the many things on which both he and Christof would agree would be the following: to fight about petty nonsense is a woeful waste of our time on earth. And during our lifetime, we have a sacred duty to show our appreciation of life by fighting for justice and the lives of others. Perhaps then, Danny, we can go back to you, and just on the more personal front, if you want to, in conclusion, just share one or two thoughts about that aspect of Christof, please.
So Franz, I used to have lunch with Christof every couple of months in Washington initially, and then here in Pretoria. And we always used to have very interesting discussions that ranged very far and wide, and I would always leave them filled with new thoughts and usually a book recommendation of one sort. But the meal that I remember most vividly took place many years ago in Washington, where Christof was asking me how I'd come to end up in Washington. And I'm a few years older than Christof, but not too many. So our life experiences sort of ran in parallel. And I was explaining to him that I'd left South Africa when I was called up to the army in the late 1970s as a draft resistor. And that's how it ended up in Washington. And he explained to me how his parents' family had reacted, how he had reacted initially to being called up into the army and was reluctant to go serve the apartheid regime, but how his family had responded to that. And the reason it meant so much to me that, and was such a profound conversation, is it made me understand how different the experience of that time, of people concerned about the politics in our country at the time, how different the experience was for people who had grown up in an Afrikaans family from people like me who'd grown up in a Jewish, English-speaking family. And how, despite that, we had managed to come together and to collaborate many years later. And it was an experience that's remained with me ever since that time.
Thank you, Danny, for sharing that. I asked Dira to also do the same, just in terms of personal memories. Thank you, Dira.
Thank you very much. I've known Christof, as I've said to you, more than half my life, so it's a little difficult. I'll just say a couple of things. So Christof and I, our offices are right next to each other, so we shared a lot. And we often talked about family and difficulties of raising children, and the difficulties of raising children, really personal stuff. I had a meeting with the dean 2 weeks before Christof's passing, and I shared with her a conversation that I'd had with Christof, And the dean said Christof had had the same conversation with her. And essentially, the central message of that conversation was, sometimes you have to do things that aren't comfortable for you. You have to do things because it's good for the faculty, even if it's not what you want to do. I think that tells me a lot about selflessness and so on. There was something else that Christof once said to me in the context of something of another personal matter, which I recalled at the memorial service last week, when his son Adam said that Christof had said to him, "You have just one chance at this. One day the light will go off, will go out." And he's told me that, and I guess the real message that one can take from that is you have to make your life count. And I think when we look back and we see all of the things that he's accomplished, everything that everybody speaks about, his life counted. And there's a lot, as the deputy dean said, there's a lot to build on. And I think it's a challenge for all of us to make sure that, one, we think beyond ourselves and we think about what contribution we can make, and two, to make sure that our lives count. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dire, for that. I think that is a burden in a sense, but a lovely, wonderful burden that we can pose on our own shoulders and remember the way in which Christof acquitted himself of that and draw from that example. Charles, if we could also hear your more personal reflections from your point of view about Christof, and with that we will conclude.
Thank you again, Franz. Let me begin by saying that the Christof I knew was an intelligent, humorous, and generous person. His clarity, his honesty, his scholarship, and his intellectual prowess were abundantly apparent in everything he said and everything he did. Many people have said the same thing, but we can never say it enough. He combined all these qualities in ways that set him apart from everyone else and placed him in a league of his own. When Christof was on campus, it was forever refreshing to stop by his office for a chat. He always had that welcoming smile and a beautiful twinkle in his eye. He never stopped asking me how he could contribute to whatever I was doing. Talking to him as I passed his office every morning always energized me. I will sorely miss him and those inspiring moments. I also knew him as a hospitable family person. He never missed an opportunity to invite me to his home and to the warmth of his family. Let me take this opportunity to say to Farika, his children and grandchild, and the rest of the family, we all thank you for giving this great man the love, peace, stability, and comfort he needed in order to accomplish the great things he did in, to, and with the world. We cannot imagine the enormity of your loss and how you feel. All we can say that God gives unasked and takes unasked. May he comfort you and give you peace. May he give you the strength to move on. We are honored by the contribution he made to greater good in our generations, and we are inspired by how he sought to leave the world a better place than the one he came into. May Christof rest in perfect peace. Thank you.
Thank you. I think that is the most appropriate way to end this panel. I just say thank you to Dira, to Charles, and also to Danny for sharing with us, and thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you very much, colleagues, for the circle of remembrance. Very inspiring talk about the journeys, the work, the collaboration you shared with Professor Heyns, personal as well as professional lives. Truly inspiring. But before we go to break, you'll agree with me, Professor Heyns, as we have known, some of us, because we are currently new in the faculty, only 5 years, the University of Pretoria, So Professor Heyns has been here for many years, but what we gather from the historical recollections of this legal giant, we remember one can sum his journey as well as the reflections of colleagues now in the circle of remembrance with a song by Vusi Mahlasela, is my homeboy from Mamelodi, titled Africa. In that song, he's saying, let us give something to the world and not just take from it. It's similar sentiments based on what Professor Heyns has done and accomplished in his journey of life, both as a professional as well as a father to his kids. So we are truly, truly privileged that we as a faculty had an opportunity to work as well as collaborate with this great giant. Colleagues, now allow me to kindly request that we have a comfort break for us who are in the law auditorium, but for those who are joining us virtually, please do not switch off. We are just going to stretch our legs as well as to comply with the COVID-19 regulations. And at 12:15, which is quarter past 12, we will continue with our program. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah. Kijk hier, zeg. 1, 2, 3.
Nog een keer, nog een keer. Nog een keer.
Kijk hier, kijk hier. Ik snij ze bij die hele boom.
Kijk of je nog niet kan kijken. Je ziet daar, je ziet recht voor van je kop in stap, ja daar. Ja. Kijk al.
Kijk even iets. 1, 2, 3.
Hey, my name is Christof Heyns. I teach law at the University of Pretoria, but I have the opportunity of being at STIAS now. It's my second time, and I find this to be a place where one is really able to get the bigger picture. My research focuses on a number of things, including peaceful assemblies. So over the last 10 years I had the opportunity of working for the United Nations, first as rapporteur on extrajudicial summary arbitrary executions, which includes the use of force by the police, and then in the last 4 years I worked with the Human Rights Committee. I was a member of the committee, and in particular in the committee we drafted a new, what is called a general comment, that sets out what are the international standards on peaceful assembly. So I had the opportunity of presenting this year in STIAS, and we're in the process now of compiling a book for Oxford University Press on peaceful assemblies. Strangely enough, there is almost nothing that's comprehensive about the right to peaceful assembly, and so we're getting about 40 people together to write from the perspective of sociologists, from the perspective of law, psychology, political science, all these backgrounds about this phenomenon of peaceful assembly. And I find this to be very interesting for a number of reasons. Here at STIAS there are people working on Gandhi, and Gandhi was, I think, a major force in establishing non-violent resistance as a strategy that people follow deliberately. For many centuries people have gathered and have express themselves, but what happened at the beginning of the last century in South Africa is that Gandhi was able to persuade ordinary people to go out of the houses and, as a matter of strategy, a deliberate decision, we are now going to protest, or it will be next week or whatever the case will be, as a political tool. And that reverberated around the world, and people saw this as a new way of dealing with opposition to government. So one can either just live with it if you don't like what government does, or on the other extreme, people engage in violence. But now there's this sort of middle ground that has been developed and has really played a major role. And so what we do with this study is then to look at how peaceful assembly has played a role in the 20th century, of course, in South Africa and in the fall of Soviet-style communism and in the civil rights movement and the Arab Spring and so forth. And of course, more recently in Black Lives Matter, and even as we speak today, protests in South Africa and of course in many other countries, Myanmar and Thailand and so on. And so now there's a new legal framework, the General Comment, and there's also a guidance on less lethal weapons that in a way restated the law on peaceful assembly. But this is largely a legal document, or these two documents, and so what we're trying to do with the book is to understand better how this works, because a lot of effort goes into understanding how war works, for example, and that's important. But if one looks at the figures today, out of 10 people who die violent deaths, one of them is in a war situation. The other are outside of war situations, and many of them in situations where the excessive use of force by the police caused their death. So I think it's an understudied area, and of course the question is, how does one de-escalate the situation? How do you make sure that the way the police deal with the assembly itself, that does not escalate? But even before that, what is the environment within which people can engage in expressing themselves? So some countries have very strict regimes that you must ask for permission, and the problems start there. Then they already don't want to do that, and it escalates right from the start. So what are the rules of engagement between the, on the one hand, the authorities, on the other hand, the public, when they engage in peaceful assembly? Because it's a very volatile situation that sometimes arises, and how can one make sure that this volatile situation is to some extent predictable in terms of what is acceptable and what is not acceptable? And that's what we hope the research will give more clarity on.
You know you only used to get juiced in it. Nobody's ever taught you how to live out on the street, and now you're gonna have to get used to it. You say you never compromise with a mystery tramp, but now you realize he's not selling it. To the vacuum of his eyes and say, do you want to make a deal? How does it feel? How does it feel to be on your own with no direction?
and the clowns when they all did tricks for you. Never understood that it ain't no good. You shouldn't let other people get your kicks for you. You used to ride on a chrome horse with your diplomat, who carried on his shoulder a Siamese cat. Ain't it hard when you discover that he really wasn't where it's at? After he took from you everything he could steal, how does it feel? How does it feel to have you on your own with no direction home, like a complete unknown, like a rolling stone? Ah, princess on a steeple and all the pretty people, they all drinking, thinking that they got it made, exchanging all precious gifts. But you better take your diamond ring, you better pawn it, babe. You used to be so amused at Napoleon in rags and the language that he used. Go to him now, he calls you, you can't refuse.
Thank you, colleagues. We are pressed for time, and also not to keep colleagues, friends, and family who are joining us virtually waiting longer. Can we please resume with our program? And now, welcome. Thank you. Welcome back. Now we move to the second circle for remembrance. In the circle, I'd like to invite Professor Andrew Borain, former dean, to please join the stage. I'd also like to call upon Professor Anne Skelton. She'll be the moderator and a colleague, and she's a senior professor in private law. I'd also like to call upon Professor Joel Mudiri, acting head jurisprudence, to also join colleagues on the street, on the stage. Colleagues, on the stage, you have 25 minutes to also reflect on your journey which you traversed with Professor Heyns, both professionally as well as personally. Thank you, Professor Skelton. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Professor Maimela. I've heard it said now from France today that Christof was a magnet, and I think that that is very true, but I also think that he was a propeller. He propelled people and projects upwards and forwards. He often gave people ideas, as we've heard from the previous circle, why don't you do this project? Why don't you come to the University of Pretoria? Why don't you join me in a project? I'm the holder of the UNESCO Chair on Education Law in Africa, and this, in many ways, is Christof's doing. The UNESCO Chair was allocated to the University of Pretoria because of Christof's work, because of the work of the Center for Human Rights as well. And when there was a long delay in the chairholder being appointed because there was no money for the chair, so it had to be someone from inside the University of Pretoria. I was the Center for Child Law. I was pretty busy. I didn't really think I had time to also take on the UNESCO chair. But I got one of those emails written in lowercase with no punctuation and no subject heading and so on that said, let me take you for lunch. And I had lunch with Christof, as many of us did, as we all have a story of one or many lunches with Christof, in which he managed to convince me that on top of everything that I was already doing, I should take on the UNESCO chair, and I did. And since then, I would say nobody could have foreseen that Fees Must Fall was going to make education law such an incredibly popular subject. And so now I have no shortage of students that want to do their master's dissertations, doctoral dissertations, and we have a great undergraduate course on education law. And all of that, really, I do because Christof convinced me that I should. And I'm glad I did. I think this story shows how he propels people, ideas, projects forward. But it also shows us how he managed to have time to have lunch. And very often when I struggle with my work-life balance, lately I've been thinking, how did Christof do it? I just don't know. Because, you know, I know that I had a lovely picnic with him in Geneva, and he brought his boombox because there always has to be music. But I probably wouldn't have done that if he hadn't convinced me, you know, that I should take that time out. No, you can still read those things you've got to read tonight. Just come for lunch now because the sun is shining. And I'm going to try. One of the things that I'm going to try to do is to see if I can get my work-life balance a little bit better. He also had such a great sense of humor. He sent me a lot of meaningful WhatsApps, but also some quite funny ones. So the last one that he sent me, maybe he sent some of you the same one, was, it said, there are three things that are really difficult to say. One is, I'm sorry. The other is, I was wrong. And another one is, Worcestershire sauce. So he's many things to many people, a lot of different experiences. And I'm turning to you, André Berain. He was the dean when you were a senior professor in the faculty. And then you took over from him and you became the dean whilst he was a senior professional in the faculty. Please share with us some of your experiences of working with Christof, our colleague.
And yes, first and foremost, I can attest to all the wonderful things that have been said about Christof because I experienced it firsthand. In fact, Christof and I were both junior staff members way back. So we've walked the walk over many years in this faculty. And yes, Christof excelled in many ways. He was the director of the center. He was the dean. I served under his direction when he was the dean. I was the HOD of the Department of Procedural Law at that point in time. And then, of course, he later also became the director of ICLA. Now, apart from being a magnet and propelling other people, etc., Christof was also a rainmaker. The one thing that I figured out quite early on when meeting with him and discussing things with him is he was not only a dreamer. I mean, it's good to be a dreamer, and some people dream and they have wonderful ideas and so on, but they can't put them into action. Now, the one thing that I learned from Christof when, as my colleague, serving under his direction as dean, and also when I became the dean, Christof was a rainmaker. And I can give many examples where he would say, well, I have this idea. I'm going to approach the university. I will meet them 50-50. I will find the funding for 50% to make this project work, but I will expect the university to contribute as well. So he had all these ideas. And he could get them through. But what I can also say, it was not only his ideas or his dreams that he put into motion, also ideas from other people. One of my initiatives as dean speaking about that was I wanted to establish a chair actually in extractive industries because I believe this is one of the areas that not only South Africa, but Africa is very tied into, and it's very important for our economic development and so on. But the big issue was to get the funding. Now, we could not immediately get the funding for a chair in that particular area, but Christof went out and he found the funder to put up the master's program in extractive industries, and in fact, we were still working towards finding funding to establish a chair in that particular area as well. But that is but one of many examples that I can name at this occasion in his honor. And I just want to say also for the younger staff members, this is very important that you must have ideas and so on, and you must dream and you must think, etc. But in the end, it's very important to follow through and to get the means to make it work. And Christof could do exactly that. And he set a wonderful example.
Yes, I think he was a dreamer who did his dreams. Joel, do you remember that at the faculty festival, Christof's band used to play We Don't Need No Education? And the students always really enjoyed it a lot. It wasn't always that wonderfully done. But, you know, we'd had a few glasses of wine by then, so it wasn't too bad. But I think his spirit around that band and trying to... The whole idea of the faculty festival actually was, of course, Christof's idea that he would give an opportunity for law students to showcase what they could do that wasn't about law. You know, trying to draw out the whole person in each student. And I think he was actually a great educator, so he didn't really believe in we don't need no education. But he also understood that education could take many different forms. So what are some of your reflections about your interactions with Christof that show those thoughts and ideas?
This mic works. Yes, I mean, I knew Christof as my dean first and foremost. He's the only dean I did not bother. I was too young then. Christof, when we first met him, in fact, we had formed a group of students who were really concerned about the first and second year curriculum at the time. We thought it was terribly boring, we thought it was conservative, and we wanted to meet the dean and the deputy dean at the time, Christof and Anton Kok. And I was just struck by his openness to, I'd seen the pictures, I knew the name is Christof Hendrik Heyns, and I thought, oh my goodness, it's going to be a problem. And I just remember the disarming charm of Christof and the openness. And I think we spent about 3 hours in his office, this is as first years, really talking about the curriculum and talking about law and talking about what would be possible for the law faculty. And he mentioned the faculty festival as one of the ways to start opening up another idea of law and the faculty. And at that point, I also discovered that he had taught jurisprudence and legal philosophy, which I also taught. So that's where my relationship with Christof really started. And it was interesting because as my own academic thinking developed, I went another way in the Department of Jurisprudence and more interested in critical theory. And of course, part of critical theory is asking questions about human rights. And just to give you a sense, one of the first articles I teach is titled The Dark Side of Human Rights, and I sent it to Christof. And I was also struck by the open-mindedness of Christof. Christof and I never agreed on the philosophical foundations and possibilities of human rights, but I never got the sense of someone who was bothered by that. In fact, I always got the sense of someone who was enriched by disagreement and debate in a really profound way. I'd run into Christof at the Exclusive Books, actually. That's one of my most compelling memories about him. And he would find me there, or I would have bought my own books, and he would want to see what I bought, and he would go back in to buy them if he was interested in them, and we'd sit there. One of the things you mentioned is the fact that Christof did so many things, but also had so much time to just sit with you for 30 minutes, or you could walk into his office at ICLA, and he would put aside what he was doing and have a discussion about faculty issues or human rights issues or whatever the case was. So I was moved by Christof's commitment to the intellectual project and the academic project of the university. Despite our disagreements about what human rights can and cannot do in the world and about the relationship between theory and practice in the teaching of human rights and in social change and social reform, it was in fact Christof who put me in touch with people at the United Nations, and I saw that as a very cheeky challenge on his part that I translate some of the theoretical work that we do into actual policy and impactful work. So despite our many disagreements over the years, philosophical, theoretical disagreements, Christof was very invested in my career. He would always check on me. He'd always refer people to me. True to the humility and the care that people have indicated about Christof, sometimes I would not know. I would arrive at a place where I'd been invited and I'd been flown there and so forth. And I'd ask, how did you know about me? I thought it was my own brilliance that led me there. But it seems that Christof always had a hidden hand in those kinds of things. And someone would say, oh no, Christof has been telling us about you for the past 5 years and we've been following your career with great interest. So the indelible mark of Christof is just so multifaceted. Because of the many ways that he's touched our careers, and certainly my first time at the UN and my relationship now with a number of global institutions and the South African Human Rights Commission was entirely Christof's doing, and that also shows you how much people trust him, because they might ask some questions. So yeah, Christof's intellectual commitments were the most moving for me. The one wrong prophecy, the one most dangerous of his prophecies, was when he said that one day I will be the dean of the faculty. And that's a dangerous idea.
Well, many of his ideas came through, so we'll have to see. You know, Christof was a rebel when he was young. And something that he and I used to talk about was the fact that, because I was also a rebel, we both said that we were lucky to find human rights, because it's a kind of respectable way of being rebellious. And both of us were able to channel our rather pointless rebelliousness as late teenagers and early adults into, you know, something more useful. We also admitted to one another that neither of us were very impressive undergraduate scholars. We were both, down there in the sort of 60s, and both wondered whether we would actually make it into the master's programs these days. And that helped us also to think about the fact that you've got to create space for students who are struggling, students who are battling to pay their fees, students who are finding it difficult to get to lectures because they have social engagements that are so important. You know, so we did kind of spend time, I think, reflecting on that and on how all of that can ultimately be channeled well if one has the right guidance on that issue. So Andre, you knew of those of us on the panel here, you certainly knew Christof the longest, and I'm sure that you and he counted one another as being close friends. And you also had parallel experiences in your families that would have brought you together as well. So would you like to share some of those thoughts and experiences with us?
Yeah, just for me, it's Christof and I shared quite a number of interests. And as you indicated, we also shared certain other matters that I'm not going to talk about. But what I can say is both of us loved sort of words, and also the humor that you pick up, the unexpected humor that you pick up in conversations, in reading, and so on. And we shared many. I still recall he came to me the one day and he said, well, there's a new album out of one of his favorite Afrikaans musicians, Valiant Swart. And he said, look what the man is saying here. Now I'm going to use the Afrikaans term, and you can't really translate it to convey the same meaning, but he said, the guy writes, ek is van mening, whisky proos is jening. So these little things we always shared and so on. And I also recall when I attended his 60th birthday 2 years ago, and he opened his speech with a twinkle in the eye, and he referred to his mother, who's still alive, she's in her 90s already, and he said, well, today my mother and I share the same status, we're both senior citizens. So Christof was a fun-loving, humorous person, apart from that, he was a very sincere person. So I sensed that, yes, we had fun together. We went out on mountain bike trips long time ago. Some of the older generation in the faculty will still remember he was driving around in a blue Willys Jeep long time ago. So we would go with the Jeep here to Klapperkop, and we would go and do some mountain bike trips there. And I also once or twice accompanied him on his famous walks here on the Proefplaas. And the thing is, yes, it was fun and everything, but there was always a serious discussion of some sorts. And the other thing, I think many people can attest to that, Christof, he took his work as a hobby. And they say the quickest way to go on a lifelong vacation is actually if your work can become fun and a hobby. And that is exactly what Christof did. So his work and his fun were intertwined. It was a mix. So we would, many of us, we know the lunches, the breakfasts, etc. And yes, we would have some discussions, etc., etc. But in the end, it would always turn to some a serious discussion of some sorts as well. So I will forever remember Christof for the good times that we had together, and I will also take from him the way in which he engaged with his friends. So for me, that was very special.
Yes. Turning back to you, Joel, Christof certainly wasn't afraid of ideas that even if he disagreed with, he would always engage. I had a couple of conversations with him about whether corporal punishment of children amounts to violence and why it does. And I'm glad to say that he actually did reach some kind of good conclusion on that and sent me an email from Stellenbosch recently, shortly before he died, on that point. But we had some really good, interesting conversations about that. So did you find that Christof was open to engagement on a wide range of issues, and how important do you think that is for academia?
Yes, no, I mean, I think that is one of the things, talking about Christof as an intellectual, not simply a scholar, but as someone who's constantly interested in all kinds of ideas. My own academic journey started with the reading of two copies of the Pulp Fictions, actually. The first Pulp Fictions was a debate between him and my supervisor, mentor, Karen van Marle, and another was Tsepo Matlingozi and Anton Kok. And that was mind-blowing to me because I thought law was going to be what we were learning and the kind of rules and so forth. But here were lawyers, were talking about art, they were talking about music, they were talking about social change, they were talking about history and politics. So that Pulp Fictions, of course, was again some of the ideas that Christof thought about enabling debate, that it's put the debate out there. Another debate that Christof wanted was around Jan Smuts, Gandhi, and Steve Biko. We had myself, Christof, and another colleague in the faculty had worked on these three figures as part of our doctoral studies, and he wanted us to have a discussion because, of course, I have serious problems with Jan Smuts and Gandhi, as one must. This was, in fact, the most contentious of our debates, with Christof over Jan Smuts, about can you be a humanitarian and a white supremacist at the same time. What struck me was his composure. This was his hero, you know. I went in pretty hard because that's what we do as scholars. So I'm very And then you'd get an email 3 weeks later saying, oh, I just found this book on Jan Smuts that's a middle ground between us and so forth. So that was the kind of way in which Christof thought ideas should be bridged. There's a pamphlet published in 2007, Transformation in the UP Faculty of Law, that he co-published with Hans Visser. I never met Hans Visser, but I know something about his history and politics. So Christof's real commitment to clashing ideas, being given airtime and space for ventilation towards the growth of an institution, is the second part of his work as an intellectual, but also as an institution builder. Near the sort of last few years that we spoke, was very interested in cross-departmental activity. So we did a research seminar in the Department of Jurisprudence on the right to life, but of course there was a private law perspective, a jurisprudence perspective. And he sent me an email saying, this is exactly what a faculty of law should do. This was a very difficult time in the faculty. And his thing was not to get into that, but to actually get people doing productive academic exchange and debate, because I think he thought and knew that we would come to a greater respect for each other if we listened to each other's thoughts and realized maybe this person's not that bad. They read and they, you know. So, yeah, there's a lot I can say about Christof's commitment to debate as a way of enriching the life of an academic institution, and his understanding that we will only we can only get better by encountering difficult intellectual frameworks and intellectual ideas. He was also very clear about where he stood, so he did not, bend easily. And so when he conceded, you knew that you had actually convinced someone who's not actually easily convinced and someone who thinks things through very carefully. That's one of the things I want to say about Christof, is his commitment to intellectual exchange and intellectual debate as the way in which you get an academic institution solidified and unified around common goals. The common goals of this faculty are going to be intellectual, sharing of ideas, getting to know each other, but also obviously always scaffolded by the social. One of the things I very seriously will inherit from Christof is the fact that this faculty must invest in good refreshments and catering.
Yes, indeed. Well, that seems to be a good moment to draw this to a close. I think one of the things that I take away is Christof's absolute faith in young people, his intergenerational approach. And, you know, he used to like to say, all the problems of the world can be solved through moot courts, and young people arguing moot courts is the way to go. So I think that we can look forward to a future of many generations of our students going forward, representing us on that global stage that he was such a big leader on, and he would be so proud to see them do it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, colleagues, for those insights and the discussion, reflecting on the journey which you had with the late Professor Heyns. Truly appreciated. Ladies and gentlemen, you would note that the colleagues just said a number of very powerful words: propeller, magnet, rainmaker. I'm adding to that list, blesser of human rights. Without any further ado, ladies and gentlemen, because we are pressed for time and we only receive 10 minutes from the diary of the VC of the University of Pretoria, Professor Tawana Kupe, without any further ado, I'd like to invite the Dean to please welcome as well as introduce the VC of the University of Pretoria, Professor Skuman.
Thank you, Professor Maimela. It is now my privilege to introduce the Principal and Vice Chancellor of the University, Professor Tawana Kupe. We were very fortunate towards the end of last year when Professor Kupe hosted a webinar from Future Africa, where Christof spoke at length about his work on peaceful and not so peaceful assemblies. And when I think back now, I just appreciate the fact that we had that webinar when we had it, that we did not wait till this year. So without wasting any time, I would like to ask Professor Kupe to address us, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Dean Professor Skuman. Can you hear me? Thank you, Professor
Skuman. Yes, VC, we can hear you.
Okay, thank you very much. Good afternoon, good evening, good morning, because people are listening from around the world to this celebration of Professor Christof Heyns' life. I speak here not because simply because I'm the Vice Chancellor. I also got to know through, frankly, his own extension of his spirit of generosity to me when he was when he turned down being renominated to the Human Rights Committee. He shared with me that decision because the minister had written to him and informed me that he would be taking more time for activities in the university in South Africa, on the continent, and his family. And then he said also he was prepared to help me and work with me. I did not think he would have the time for a vice chancellor. So many top professors doing their own thing at the top of their league, being very busy making a difference, often do not necessarily have a time for a vice chancellor, and I have no problem with that because they make a greater contribution than, if you like, sort of hanging with the VC. So we agreed that he would come and meet, and we sat in my office and we discussed the things that he could assist me with. And from thence on, we were fairly close, I would say, and I asked for his advice on a number of things, of course, some of them on a fairly confidential basis. So today I sit here with a number of very difficult emotions since he passed on. Of course, the sadness that all of us share, the loss and the belief that really is, there is, I believe often, and I say to people that graveyards are full of irreplaceable people, but then there are exceptions. And in that dictum, I consider a Professor Christof Heyns an exception to that dictum. Also, I mean, as I said, I sit here not talking as a vice chancellor, but also somebody who got to know and somebody who's fighting a number of conflicting emotions and feelings. On the one hand, I celebrate his life. I see his legacy. It will not die. But I feel the deep sense of loss and the gap that he has left. As a human being, also often sometimes, things happen at the same time that are conflicting. On the one hand, as a person and just as a human being, I might be sitting with an emotion here where I think I met someone who might be a significant other and there is joy, but here I've lost a very dear person who I think is an intellectual giant, a Pan-African cosmopolitan global activist. And so that is life. And Christof had gifted me, by the way, the book, The Humanist, and we exchanged a few text messages on it. He said he couldn't draw, that is on the 1st of February. He said he couldn't put the book down. It was interesting. He thought, though he didn't, wasn't sure, he agreed with some of the things and we had agreed to discuss it. But those were my off-the-cuff remarks, if you like, at the beginning of this celebration, commemoration, as well as the sadness that all hangs on us. Ever since we heard the shocking news of Professor Christof Heyns' untimely passing, tributes have poured in from every corner of the globe. Heartfelt eulogies from people whose lives were profoundly touched by what can only be accurately described as this giant of a man, this giant of a human being. He was greatly admired and respected, both for his contributions to the advancements of human rights around the world, as well as for his personal characteristics. A man of wisdom and humility, great warmth and generosity, and humor with a complete zest for life. I enjoyed listening to the family memoriam on Saturday, which I attended in person, because I saw the full rounded nature of the man, some of it testimonies from his very direct family who have suffered this loss together with us. He was a colleague, teacher, mentor, and friend to so many at UP, and we all miss him terribly. Our deepest condolences go out to his wife, Erika, children, Renee, Philemon, and Adam, and other family members. When reflecting on Christof's extraordinary accomplishments and character, I will refer to him as Christof from now on, as he often insisted on being called, even to those who cringed at the prospect of addressing him as anything but Prof. It is clear that he was a big person in every sense, a big man with a big intellect and a big heart. And yet there were so many little things that made up his deep humanity. People are full of big and little things. And as we reflect on his life and all that it has meant to so many, let us cherish the monumental and the minor. For together, they paint the picture of a person who could only inspire us all to be better versions of ourselves and to strive to leave the world a better place than we found it. Christof's father, Johann Heyns, an independent-minded and outspoken reformist, sowed a small seed of a worldview to his son, which Christof summarized as being this seed of love being about creating space for people. Perhaps blossomed into Christof's huge passion for human rights as he devoted his life to creating a better life for vulnerable people in South Africa, our continent, Africa, and around the world. For he was a global humanist. Just the retired Deputy Chief Justice Dihang Moseneke said in his tribute that he personally knew Christof in the dark days of apartheid and colonialism. And like many others, he says, Christof opposed apartheid openly and embraced notions of an inclusive and socially just society. In a joint appreciation from the alumni of the master's degree in human rights and democratization in Africa, the scholars acclaimed Christof's establishment in 1986 of the Center for Human Rights, together with Johan van der Westhuizen at the then white and conservative University of Pretoria, is an achievement in itself. those who were at my inauguration will remember that the second paragraph in my speech was exactly about the Center for Human Rights and the Center for Child Law as beacons of the transformation of the University of Pretoria, which even if not complete, has gone some way towards affirming all our common humanity. Christof's motto was, as the motto of the Center for Human Rights, from human wrongs to human rights. They recalled this optimism about a non-racial future for South Africa based on human rights and the rule of law, and how he worked tirelessly for a new and democratic South Africa, making an important contribution to our renowned constitution. Christof achieved some pretty big things in his career. And here I apologize because I couldn't attend all of the other speeches. I did attend the first 30 minutes. He held the degrees MA, LLB from UP, and LLM from Yale Law School, and a PhD from WITS. I forgive him to go into WITS, but also now I'm glad he created a PhD program. And we saw the Hall of Commemoration earlier in this ceremony that he has created for PhD graduates at the University of Pretoria. I understand also that the Faculty of Law at the University of Pretoria is one of the largest producers of PhD graduates in human rights and the law. He was an adjunct professor at the Washington College of Law of the American University, and since 2005, a visiting fellow at Kellogg College at Oxford University. Also held several positions at UP, already referred to the founding directorship of the Center for Human Rights up to 2006, became Dean of the Faculty of Law for 4 years, then became founding co-director, as you know, of ICLA, or the Institute for International and Comparative Law. He was especially, and I know many have said this, but I would like to repeat that in my own voice. He was especially passionate about moot courts and built UP moot from the ground up. Last year, I had the honor of going with the center to Botswana for their annual moot court. And in 2020, I would have gone to Senegal with them. And this year, I hope to be in Stellenbosch with them. It was a source of honor and pride for me that one could attend these institutions created by giants like Christof and his colleagues. Not to mention, of course, conceptualizing several distinguished moot competitions, including the Nelson Mandela World Human Rights Moot Competition. From 2010 to 2016, Christof served as the United Nations Special Rapporteur on extrajudicial summary or arbitrary executions. His many important achievements in that role, including a groundbreaking report on lethal autonomous robotics and the right to life. He also played a key role in helping to update the Minnesota Protocol on the investigation of potentially unlawful death, published in 2016, and in the same year, chaired the independent investigation on Burundi. From 2017, he took on his most recent role of being a member of the Human Rights Committee, and that he told me about. He led the drafting of the widely acclaimed General Comment number 37 on the right of peaceful assembly, which was published last July. As the dean just referred to in her introduction before I spoke, my last event of 2020 was on 16 December, Reconciliation Day in South Africa. That day, Ms. Abigail Noko, the regional representative for the UNHSSRC, Franz and I were part of a global webinar at Future Africa, at what we now call the University of Pretoria TV studios, to discuss the guidelines. I had to give a keynote address, which of course, lots of input from himself and Franz. And there again, I saw the intellect, the stature of the man, but also his humility and his ability to be versatile in addressing the issues. He also led the team that drafted the UN Human Rights Guidance on Less Lethal Weapons in Law Enforcement, launched 2 months earlier in May 2020. On that day, when I sat in that room, after I'd given the address, and then the three, Abigail, Christof, and Franz, then debated the issues and the other panelists, I was very humbled, and also learned a lot from the three, and also learned a lot from other panelists, and also learned a lot about how we'd been able to draw people together to produce things of depth that have meaning for humanity. Christof's tireless efforts in educating several generations of students to become accomplished human rights lawyers is an important part of his legacy. And it is here that the little things show their profound impact. A student from Burundi recalls meeting him in Geneva and being surprised by his humbleness, how he shared with her his challenges of back in time when he was a student in a foreign country. He was a unique professor, she says. His way of teaching would attract anyone to get interested in human rights, given his passion and knowledge. Another student remembers a lecture he gave in Oxford. His dilemmas and the way he explained them to the audience became our own dilemmas on the topic for years to come. He was such good fun to be with, always ready to laugh with the next joke, the perfect host, and the list goes on. A photograph on a tribute page shows a group of students huddled around laptops at Christof's dining room table. One of the students writes, "Where is the family, you might ask?" Well, as always, human rights took center stage and we happily decamped to the kitchen. We couldn't get access to campus and so we were there, not for a day, but for a week with Prof leaving us to eat and coming through every now and then to answer our questions. There is no doubt that Christof was an ideas person, always brimming with enthusiasm over the next project and with the solid determination to follow through on them. He started everything from Tax Radio, being an academic in the space of media. I'm really very proud of that. I didn't actually know that until I started preparing for this eulogy. And Reghus to the annual faculty festival, FACFest, and SASFO, the student volunteer program started in 94, which saw volunteers work alongside communities on existing development projects. Anyone working closely with him will be familiar with these so-called 3 a.m. mails, mostly one-liners with no subject line or punctuation, but always about the bigger picture. These were the vintage Christof, and I'm sure many of his visions and brilliant ideas were conjured up in the wee hours of the morning and pursued in daylight and at night. There's also the fact that with so much on his plate, there's little wonder that he had to work at 3 a.m. For as much as Christof gave to his work life, his tremendous effort was duplicated in his personal life. I had some of this on Saturday. His love and investment in his family, his friends, that would include his band and his hobbies, the outdoors and simply enjoying life. He was active and self-skied and mountain biked. He adored literature and music. And you all remember, those who know him much more intimately and have known him much longer, him playing guitar in the Outlaws and how the band's appearances lit up many a staff event. Ferika attests to Christof, his dear wife Ferika, being the glue of their family, and that they were always his first priority. He relished in becoming a grandfather this past year, and one of his last videos circulated was of little Isaac laughing gleefully every time Christof pruned a branch of a tree in his garden. The video was called "Why I Chopped Down My Entire Tree." Now that a great tree has fallen, where does that leave us? To quote Maya Angelou's poem, "When God souls die, the air around us becomes light, rare, sterile. We breathe briefly, our eyes briefly see with hateful clarity." As we mourn and reflect, we cannot but come back to the call of Christof's life and legacy. He was one of South Africa's greatest activists, and activism is always a rush and always urgent. Speaking after his father's tragic murder in 1994, Christof said that something like that makes you much more sensitive to the plight of others and aware of the limited that time you have to make a difference. And he's a man who lived by making a decisive difference, I dare say almost every day. He said that his response was to throw himself into his work, that being creative offered an opportunity to try and make sense of a country which has so much of its people. The COVID-19 pandemic has heightened and exposed glaring income inequality in South Africa like never before. Millions live in desperate and undignified conditions. globally, we face multiple disruptions and crises. As a university community, we are all poised, we should all be poised to come up with strategies which we can collaboratively implement to achieve social justice and equality. We can be inspired to do the big things while not forgetting the little out of sight actions and other people-centeredness that spoke such volumes in Christof's life. We have the greatest role model you could ever have. There's a paragraph in one of Christof's short stories published on LitNet, A Funeral at Still By, which reads, he feels the warmth of the old man's arm around his shoulders and then the pat on his back. I know. The world can be a terrible place. You won't be able to change that. But you are prepared for it as much as anyone can be. You'll be okay if you use what you have to make it better. Thank you, Son of Africa, for your immense contribution. Thank you, global cosmopolitan activist and advocate. We will do our best to live out your legacy and make it better. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Vice Chancellor Professor Tawana Kupe, for your moving tribute in honor of the late Professor Heyns, and also to reaffirm to us as a faculty, the broader university community, society, and the international community about the footprint which this legal giant has really made and left behind. Us as young scholars will continue to fight the good cause in ensuring that human rights, transformation, among other things, are fully materialized based on the torchbearer which Professor Heyns has left with us. Colleagues, friends, members of the community and the family, it would be a great injustice if we celebrate the life of Professor Heyns and do not include a discussion on the side of students, because students is what really drives Professor Heyns. And as you heard on the number of occasions from speaker to speaker, that he was very passionate about young people, in particular his brainchild pertaining to moot courts. Allow me now to call on the third circle of remembrance. The first person to be called to the stage is Miss Caroline Ngube. She's an alumni and former Letswalo, I beg your pardon. She's a former alumni of the faculty. The second person to join her is Nyambeni Davana, also an alumni as well as a Muta. The third person to join is Keketso Homosoto, and she will also be serving as a moderator. The last person to join the circle is Khumulemo Sibeko, the current chairperson of Law House. Ladies and gentlemen, we are pressed for time, so we'll stick strictly to time for 25 minutes. Thank you, and over to you, moderator.
Thank you very much. Thank you for giving us an opportunity to make some reflections from our side on our experience with Professor Christof Heyns. Maybe I should keep this a little bit further. I met Professor Heyns in 2009. I was 17 years old, and it was in this very room. I was competing in the school's moot court competition in high school. And I had gotten third place, and the prize for third place was a handshake with the dean of the Faculty of Law. So it was right over there where I met Christof Heyns for the very first time. But I felt it was more that meeting was more impactful, not just meeting the person, but also having engaged in the school's moot court competition. For me, that experience was the constitutive reason I decided to pursue law as a profession. After I was in grade 11 at the time, and after the moot competition, I went back to school where I was registered for a science route, and I deregistered all my subjects at grade 11. Of course, my parents thought I was crazy, and I just registered, you know, subjects that I thought would help me become a better lawyer. And that's how important and how impactful the National Schools Moot Court Competition is. I've seen it both with myself, and I've seen it with many other students and learners that I've worked with after my own experience, whose lives have been enriched and impacted positively just by the exposure of the school's moot court competition, but also many other moot competitions that Christof conceptualized and supported in many other ways, including the African Human Rights Moot Court, the World Moot Court, as well as the Jessup. So after my experience with the National Schools Moot Court, I went to the University of Venda. I couldn't afford to come to UP. But then after that, I got a bursary at the university, and I insisted on transferring back to UP because of this experience I've had with Schools Moot, and I wanted more of that. And that's where Prof. Heyns and I, you know, started working much more closely on the Jessup and various other moots. And we went on to, with, of course, made possible largely by his financial, by his support institutionally and financially, to get us funding for these ridiculously expensive trips to all over the world to represent South Africa. We did really well on the moot front, and it was made possible only by you know, his support and his push. One of the things that Christof taught me was that anything is achievable. You can achieve, you can do anything. I remember when he first had conceived this idea that we could win the Jessup as an African university. And you know, the last time that happened was in 2002, and I think in Prof. Dire's year as well. No. I think UP was second in Prof. Dire's year, yes. Christof thought we could do it, and we could do it again. And you know, we came very close one year. We ended up fifth, and I never thought we could do it. As a boy who grew up in Tembisa, I never once thought that I could be good enough to compete with universities like Oxford, Yale. But Christof saw something in me that I perhaps wasn't able to see at the time. And that just exemplifies the kind of approach he had to students. But he also didn't expect me to be perfect, right? In 2015, I failed a module and I lost my bursary. I dropped out, got a job, and 3 months later he found out, and you know, he called me and said, "Rubbish, you absolutely have to come back and complete your LLB degree." And I wouldn't have been able you know, to complete in the time that I did my LLB degree, and likely wouldn't have been able to complete it anyway had it not been for his intervention. And for that, I'm grateful, and for so much more after that as well. He invested tremendously in my development, in my career. My entire CV involves Christof in one way or the other. And you know, he spoke to other people about me as well. And as a result, I got invited to the UN to address the UN on human rights, on the role of moot courts in advancing human rights. So for me personally, this is a deep, incalculable loss. And it's a deep loss for the student body in South Africa, and specifically at the University of Pretoria. And on that note, I want to turn to Caroline. Could you share with us some of your experiences with Christof?
So I came in at the university in 2016. I was a first year. My dean was Prof. Bahrain, and he was a senior professor at the faculty. So when I was just elected into the Law House EC in 2018, I met him in the elevator, and he saw this blazer that I'm wearing now. He's like, "Do you know me and my friends started Law House in 1979? And I was like, "Eh?" I was not born then. He's like, "Yes, we started it. It was a group of me and my friends. We decided that the academics in the faculty need to make sure that in order for it to be a faculty, it needs its students." And I was like, "That was a great plan. And I'm very fortunate that I'm part of this thing that you started." And that's when things started making sense, his involvement in the faculty festival with the outlaws, because as a first year, I was like, "Who are these old men singing rock?" and why is he enjoying himself? And I was told that that's something that happens yearly, and then it made sense. So leading up to 2018, we are preparing for the annual faculty festival. It's always centered around a theme that the EC gets to choose. We chose the Year of the Woman. He comes up, he's like, why did you guys choose this specific theme? And I told him, I was honest, I'm like, I'm doing my third year, I'm doing jurisprudence, and I just got introduced to this term called feminism. And we were debating with my EC around it, and we said we want to incorporate it into our term. He said, that's beautiful, I would like to sit in one of your meetings. But obviously, that never happened because he was always busy, but he always had time for students. Whenever Law House had a problem or we needed funding, we would obviously run to the dean's office. If then we go to the Center of Human Rights, then we go to ITLA, and he would always help. He would be like, do you need help with refreshments, or do you need help with transportation, or whatnot? Then he would give us the help. Then he would always pop in the office every time when he's done at the cafeteria, at the kiosk. He just said, I just came to say hi. Did you know that me and my friends started Law House in 1970? I'm like, yes, prof, we do. And I think that every EC member in Law House will let you know of that story that he always told. And he told it with the immense joy and pride in his face. If I remember correctly, it was also in 2018, he had asked Unyambeni to organize student leaders in the faculty to come and meet the judge president of the Gauteng Division High Court, JP Mlambo, and just for lunch. Like, I just heard everyone just says, Christof invites you for lunch. We were our faculties, we went to ITLA, and we sat down, and he looked at us like, this is not my lunch, I'm not hosting you, we are all having lunch. And here we are in awe, we have a whole judge president sitting next to us. And he said, I brought you guys here to see how it is out there. But also, I brought Judge Mlambo here so he can see how it is down here. And at the end of that lunch, Judge Mlambo said, I gained more than you guys did because it reminded me of my years when I was still a student. I would have not thought that I would be sitting here as a judge president. And I will be forever be grateful of how he supported and encouraged young legal minds. He always supported us. And he gave us support in terms of saying, what are your research outputs? What do you plan on writing your dissertation on? Do you need sources? There's a PLSR. Do you know that? Do you know you can publish the? And it was a collaborative thing with a student back then in 2019, where Prof. Borain said, I want you, Caroline, to write a paper along with another student for SALDA. And I remember going to consult him on a paper that he wrote specifically on social economic rights in South Africa. And after that, he did not stop engaging me on the topic, saying, how's the paper going? And what do you see yourself doing? Are you going to enroll for a master's? Way, let me know. So I just want to say thank you, Christof.
Thank you very much, Caroline, for those reflections. Christof was very invested in the student bodies at the University of Pretoria, and I'm turning to you, Khumalim, as well as the chair of the of Law House. And a lot of his work continues to live on, and I have no doubt will continue to live on beyond us as well. What are some of your reflections as a student leader yourself, having engaged with Christof's legacies?
Thank you, KK. I'd be lying if I am saying that I did have the opportunity to work directly with Professor Heyns, you know. But at the same time, I feel like it's something quite amazing and beautiful to realize that I got to benefit, and not just myself, but every other, you know, student who's involved in student leadership, to be involved and be so empowered by what he has actually bequeathed upon us as the law students here at UP. So it's a huge loss for us as students here at the University of Pretoria. But at the same time, we've actually gotten so much from this great person. And I think it's our responsibility at this stage to actually ensure that we uphold everything that he has left us with, and we carry it forward, and we see to it that it actually even grows to more than what he has actually left for us. So yeah, thank you for the opportunity.
Thanks, Khumulimo. I think that's the, I've been thinking about the same thing as well, of how do we move forward Christof's legacy in our different respective ways. And I was thinking about my own contribution specifically. But Nyembeni, I know that you know, you're also having similar thoughts. Can you tell us about your work specifically with coaching international teams? How far Christof's work and ideas is able to propel even, you know, beyond his immediate, the people immediately around him, how he's able to impact the lives of children in the most poorest of schools in this country.
Thank you, Gegetso. So I met Christof through Moot Court, and we initially met in 2014, but we only got to work together very closely around 2016. So it was through the National Schools Moot Court competition. Now, everyone who's ever encountered Christof will know that he said he believes that every problem in the world can be solved through moot courts. And that is exactly what he did. So when I started coordinating the moot with him, he says to me, "Yeah, Nyambeni, you know, this thing is very massive now. It's growing. And I think we can do better than we are. It's been 10 years now, more than 10 years. We can expand it. What do you think?" Prof, yes, that's a good idea, but it's a national schools moot court competition. Yeah. But think of it from a continental perspective. What about roping in other countries? You know, and then I thought to myself, Prof, you've created this massive creature where each and every high school learner can participate. And that is not where you want to stop. And you wanted to expand into other jurisdictions from a high school level. So I said, okay, Prof, that sounds like a good idea. Now, after he would do that, after creating the idea, he would get your buy-in. Then he would then let you run with it. He would propel you to go with it. Now that you've agreed, it is now your baby. So he would say, okay, now since you agree, I think I know contacts in Ghana, in Ethiopia, in Mozambique. Shall I send them through to you? And then we can get this thing going. Okay, Prof, yes. And then you can conceptualize everything as per conversation. You know how everything runs, okay? Yes, and that would be him. He would not only get your buy-in into an idea, but he would also let you take ownership of it after seeing how relevant it is. Because he saw moots in an entirely different way. We would think learners come, they argue for the applicant and respondent, and then they go home. But we would attend many meetings, Christof and I, and on our drives there and back, he would say to me, we would have a discussion. Nyambeni, I'm just thinking on the school's moot and, you know, the constitution. You know, the whole point is that this thing is so massive that it reaches the communities. And one way in which we can do that is if learners go back home with a problem and they engage with it with their parents. That way the constitution is in their homes. And I thought, wow, that is a totally different take on it, because we think, get them physical copies of the constitution and let them run with it. But he says, no, it goes beyond that. Let them have a conversation on human rights in their households. If they have it as part of their homework, let them deal with it in that context and speak to their parents and say, I'm struggling with this. Then the debate starts, and then they ask, what is this about, you know, and get involved. And he cared so much about moots to the extent that
If you had a problem with anything moot court competition related, you could go into his office and he will find a solution. If he can't find a solution, he will delegate it to someone to find it. So I got involved in schools moot and a lot of international moot court competitions. And one thing I started realizing about Prof is he was a very busy man, but he always had time. He would say, okay, when are you practicing? We're practicing in December and January. Over the holidays? Yes. Shall I pop in? Prof, well, if you're available, just let me know, even if it's just to say hi. Send me your problem statement. Let me read it. And even if I don't know, have expertise in the areas, I'll sit and I'll give you advice and pointers, you know, to the team. That's how committed he was. And his commitment also spanned to a financial level. You could be stranded. And Prof would say, okay, Nyambeni, right now I don't know what to do, but shall I give you my credit card? And then we'll figure it out later. And you'd be in a position where you really can't say yes. And say, okay, well, you can't say no, you know, and then because he's already holding his wallet and he says, take, let's solve this. That's how committed he was. Things such as visas. I know of many students who would come to Prof's office saying, We are traveling to the US and we're struggling to get visas. And Prof would say, I don't know anyone in particular, but we can solve it. And he would get involved to that level and follow up constantly until he knows that you're on the flight and until he knows that you've arrived where you need to. Call me, let me know, no matter what time it is. So that was my involvement with Prof. And as we speak, now we have schools moot in Ghana, schools moot expanding to Nepal, schools moot expanding to Kenya, and schools moot expanding to Uganda. So he was a visionary and he was very proactive in that sense.
Thank you, Nyambeni. What comes to mind is Christoph's real ability to maintain sight on the bigger picture, right? He would Christoph you into these things. you'd have to work with the Department of Education, which is not a small feat. But even in your frustration, he would be able to center you and remind you of the bigger picture, that this is why we got involved in the first place and this is why we agreed to it in the first place. And he always celebrated students' achievements as well. We have a wall of fame in the faculty where we have all the mooters' names up. And we're here to celebrate him today. And it's so much to celebrate. I, you know, in my emotional processing, on the way here, I was trying to imagine, if I had a tummy bug that morning in 2009 and I didn't meet him or couldn't compete in the school's moot. And I wondered what my life would have looked like. I think having met Christof undeniably enriched my life in ways that, you know, I couldn't imagine as a kid, and I'll be forever grateful to him for that and to his family for allowing us to share in Christoph's life as well. And to his family, I'd like to say that actually there isn't anything to say. This is a deep loss. There are no words. I hope you find acceptance, comfort in knowing that he did so much for us, and thank you. And I think with that, we'll close the session. Thank you, Prof.
Thank you very much. We could not conclude paying tribute to Professor Heyns without an important contribution by the students, which is very key. The students were very dear to Professor Heyns, and that's affirmed based on the recollections which the student community has just shared. And Homulemo, Mr. Sibegwe's chair of Law House, COVID is just an enemy for this year, but we'll definitely strive to have a proper faculty festival where we will theme it. We don't need no education, as Professor Skelton has said, in honor of Professor Heyns, but we will surely strive for that. And furthermore, a challenge is we are going to prioritize moot courts as in honor of Professor Heyns. We need to coordinate it, and we requested an agent meeting with a number of colleagues in the various departments to ensure that the Dean's Office fully supports
this great initiative in honor of Professor Heyns. So we are surely taking the challenge and ensuring that the legacy of Professor Heyns is fully realized and is kept alive. We are rolling our sleeves up, as Professor Heyns would always often do, to ensure that the work gets done, and will ensure that even though he is no longer with us, we will surely ensure that his legacy continues and generations to come are able to benefit from the work of this great giant. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my great honor now to just say and express a word of gratitude from the side of the faculty management, as well as the university broadly, that we conveyed this today, this morning, in honor of Professor Heyns. We can continue on and on to be able to share and give perspectives of the recollections of Professor Heyns, but it can take days and days because of the amount of work which he has done, the people which he shared his experiences with all over the world. We can go on and on, but ultimately, as I've said, we have to roll our sleeves up and get the work done. From my side, as well as from the Office of the Dean, I'd like to conclude by saying to us as a faculty, to the student community, staff members, society in general, and the international community, that despite the death of Professor Heyns, let us find comfort, solace, and peace in the Almighty. Let us find strength in the contribution which Professor Heyns and the foundation he has laid for us as a faculty. And as a faculty, in honor of Professor Heyns, it is very important that let's put as a priority in our daily activities, in our interactions with the students as well as colleagues, that peace and collegiality should be the main things which we strive for. Because in all the summaries which we got today and the reflections about the journey of Professor Heyns, he championed for peace throughout the world. And this duty must rest with us as a faculty to lead by example and be exemplary to the community that we are living with this motto of peace and collegiality in our faculty. From our side as a faculty, we'd like to thank you once more for attending this memorial in honor of Professor Heyns. There will be another memorial on the 28th of April, which will be hosted by the Office of the Vice Chancellor of the University, which will be streamed live at Future Africa, where also other people which Professor Heyns worked with will be afforded an opportunity to pay their last respects. From our side as a faculty, we are thanking you, and we express a great deal of gratitude to the production team this morning and afternoon. We are very much thankful and appreciative of your efforts. To Ms. Hata LZ, thank you for making this event a wonderful event. All the logistics were running very smooth. From our side, we'd just like to invite you for something to eat outside as we exit the hall. But thank you very much and enjoy the rest of your afternoon. Thank you.
Laat ons nie praat nie, die tijd is voorbij. Niemand is kwaad nie, en albei is vrij. Kom kijk deur die ruiten, die nacht staan een blom, woorden hoort buiten, want hartzeer is stom. Lee je kop hier tegen mijn schouder, laat je hart zij pijn gaan. Stilweg wordt ons wijs en ouder. Een dag zal ons dat verstaan, maar tot die rijp kraak onder schoenen wat geen ander hart of thuis ons kent. Gun ik mij nog visioenen van een wat de hele wereld wint. jy hoor my nie meer nie. Ek sê maar tot ziens, ek sal jou nie steur nie. Ek loop ongeseens, want jy is in orde waar drome nog blom. Ek groet sonder woorde, want hartseer bestom. En jy is in orde waar drome nog blom. Ek groet sonder woorde, want hartseer bestom.
Must a man walk down before you call him a man?